Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Quarrelsome Quartz by Mildred Abbott. Narrated by Angie Hickman. 1. A pop sounded, drawing my attention to the glowing embers in the river rock fireplace. I'd lost track of time. I could have sworn the fire had been roaring pleasantly only moments ago. Settling back into the sofa, I adjusted the book so the light from the dusty purple fabric of the antique lampshade filtered onto the page. The words seemed to swirl together, lists of precious stones and crystals correlating with chakras in the body and differing attributes. Black obsidian helped a person feel grounded. It was recommended they sleep with it in their pillow or clutched in their fist. I reread the suggestion, thinking I had misunderstood. Who would sleep with a rock in their pillow or in their hand? I hadn't misread it. How bizarre. I moved on to rose quartz, a pretty pink crystal that assisted a person to connect with love. I stopped right there. I wasn't sure if it meant romantic or self-love or something else, but I didn't need to know. After ending a relationship a few weeks before, love was the last thing I wanted to think about. Although, I supposed it hadn't really been a relationship, perhaps just the beginning of one, or the promise of one, something. Good grief. That was exactly why I was skipping rose quartz. I didn't want to think about it, didn't want to spend any more time trying to figure it out. So I moved on again. Clear quartz correlated with the seventh chakra and was apparently the master healer of the stone world. They even amplified the energy of other crystals while assisting a person to connect to their higher self, while also acting as a spiritual guide. I had to reread that, too. A crystal could be a spiritual guide? I had to shut my eyes and remind myself to keep an open mind. My mother was a strong believer in the power of the elements. And with the week-long New Age conference, Estes Park was about to be filled to overflowing with people just like her. Elemental Power was written by the keynote speaker of the event, so I wanted to be prepared. But I figured I was wasting my time. None of this was sinking in to any useful degree. A loud snort brought me back to the moment, and I reopened my eyes to peer through the two doorways that led to the front of the bookshop, where Watson rose from his nap. He stretched his tiny corgi legs in front of him while arching his knob of a tail in the air and let out an exaggerated yawn. Finally, he gave a little shake, glanced out the large wall of windows at the growing night sky, and then leveled his stare on me. I had no trouble reading his expression, and I offered him a glare of my own. "I know it's past dinner time, but you had endless snacks today, as always. You'll survive, trust me. You're not even close to withering up and blowing away." Watson trotted from the front room of the bookshop that held general fiction and new releases, through the following room made up of science fiction and fantasy novels, and joined me in the mystery room, which was my favorite location in the Cozy Corgi Bookshop. He cast a judgmental glance at the fireplace, clearly thinking, not for the first time, that his mother was a crazy woman. Which, considering I'd opened all the windows so I could light a fire in the middle of August, probably proved Watson correct. Finally, he plopped down in front of the Victorian sofa and chuffed. Giving up on the quartz, I flipped through the rest of the pages, but nothing called out to me. Mixed in with all the precious stones and New Age artwork were photos of the author and artist, Aurora Birnbaum. She was beautiful, in the expected ethereal way. Most of the photos were of her modeling the gems in one fashion or another, but there were a few candid shots from her life as well, speaking to large crowds of people, trips to India, with her husband who drew a design on the ground as she stood nearby. These photos were just as prevalent as the ones featuring the crystals. While they seemed a bit indulgent, at least I'd be able to recognize Aurora if she came into the store, even if I wouldn't remember any of the elemental powers. Watson chuffed again, more emphatically. Instead of answering his demand for dinner, I held the book out to him. "What do you think? Would you take a hit out on me if I put a piece of black obsidian under your dog bed? It might help you feel more grounded. He chuffed again. Yes, I agree. I should stick to fiction. With a sigh, I gave up, closed the book, and stood. I'd return it to the New Age section I'd set up at the front of the shop to correspond with a conference, and wing it for any of the practitioners who might come in during their stay. I'd been doing the same thing with my mother and stepsisters, so I supposed, if it was good enough for family, it was good enough for tourists. After gathering up my purse and slipping on Watson's leash, I paused to look around the store. I hadn't stayed after closing for quite a while. In the months of heavy tourist traffic, it had gotten easy to be caught up in the pure business aspect of my dream bookshop. I needed an hour or two to connect with it again, the way I had when it had first opened several months before. Sure enough, with the coziness of the fire in my favorite spot in the shop, and the warm aroma of the Cozy Corgi bakery overhead that now permeated every inch of the space, that little time worked its magic. Granted, it would have worked even better if I'd been reading a novel instead of something that felt like a strange kind of homework, but still. Another admonishing chuff from Watson interrupted my wave of fondness for my little bookshop, and I acquiesced, extinguishing the fire, flicking off the lights, setting the alarm, and locking up after we exited the front door. All right, buddy, let's head home. Dinner is waiting, as are books with actual plots. We made it all of 5 feet before I halted at the shop next door. Dim light filled the darkened space, and I could just make out Zelda near the rear of the store. One hand was pressed to the back wall, while the other rubbed her temples. Even from this distance, it was clear to see the weight of the world rested on her shoulders. Knowing that Watson wasn't going to appreciate what was about to happen, I tapped on the window. Zelda flinched, and her long brunette hair whipped around her face as she jerked toward the window. Her wide blue eyes appeared clearly strained, despite the distance between us. She blinked, then visibly relaxed as she recognized me and hurried through the store to unlock and throw open the door. Fred, what in the world? I thought you'd gone home hours ago. And I figured you'd still be at the conference. I should be. She sighed and nearly melted against the doorframe. Tonight's just registration. It doesn't officially begin until tomorrow, but I'm already completely overwhelmed. Zelda cast her gaze back to the shop. Every other year I've hit the ground running and was absolutely devastated by the time it was over, but I think with the added stress of owning Chakras, well, it just changes things. I'm sure once you get past this week, things will get better. It's a lot to take on with the conference happening and the official grand opening of Chakras all at once. Zelda and Verona had been transforming the old candy shop to the left of the Cozy Corgi into their version of a New Age Mecca for months, and had a soft opening a couple weeks before. At the beginning, both of my stepsisters seemed over the moon with excitement. But as time went on, bickering between them increased, and Zelda seemed more drained by the day. I reached out and squeezed her shoulder. I'm sorry that I've been so busy at the bookshop the past couple of days and haven't been able to come over to help, but I've got some time tonight if you'd like. She smiled sweetly and patted my hand. Like you haven't done enough over the months that we've been getting ready. But she released me and stepped back into the shop, making room. Why don't you come in? We've made quite a few changes since you were in last. Dad and your mom have been miracle workers. Zelda chuckled. As have your uncles. Even though it's not Percival's style, he and Gary definitely have a flair for decorating. I'd love to see what you've done. I walked in, but had to turn around as Watson's leash jerked me to a halt. He sat in the doorway, glaring. I couldn't help but laugh and patted my thigh. Come on, grumpy pants. We won't be very long. You'll still get your dinner. With a second tug on his leash, Watson complied, though his glower increased. Zelda bent with a flourish and ruffled the fur between Watson's fox-like ears, earning a glower all her own. We've got some dog treats in the back that will hold you over. Watson perked up at his favorite word and gave a little hop. I thought that would work. Zelda straightened and gave me a wink before shutting the door and leading us through the shop. I also have a treat of the human variety, as long as you can keep a secret. A sharp rap on the door, followed by Watson's yip, caused us both to flinch and whirl around. A large man stood shadowed, peering in with his hand pressed to the glass. Who in the world would be dropping by this time of... Zelda squinted, then her shoulders impossibly tightened to an even greater degree. Oh, it's Duke Reiser. She spared me a glance as she hurried to the door. He's the manager of the YMCA, where the conference is being held. Zelda flung it open. What's wrong? Without waiting, he barged past, scanning the store. His gaze fell on me, then moved on with a shake of his head. Is she here?
Who?
Zelda stood frozen by the door. Aurora. Disgust laced Duke's words. She's supposed to lead a midnight, he waffled his hands, some event or other you new agey people like for all the people who paid for early registration. Her husband and assistant are there, but who cares about them? And they weren't any help at all. He continued to inspect Chakras like Aurora was hiding around every display. I haven't seen her at all, not even when I registered. Zelda started to shut the door, then paused. Why did you think to check here? Duke finally stopped his inspection. She and your sister were talking about your shop, and I can't find Veronica either, so I figured they came here.
Verona.
Who? Duke looked at Zelda as if she were speaking a different language.
My sister is Verona, not Veronica.
At Duke's eye roll, Zelda managed a more patient response than I felt.
And I haven't seen either of them. I'm sure they'll show up. Verona is probably helping prepare stuff in Aurora's room. Did you check there?
Unlike the attendees of the Spirit, Health, and Heart Conference, I am not a moron. Of course I checked her room. I could smell sage seeping from under the door, though no one answered. Duke strode back to Chakra's front door. The entire YMCA smells like burnt sage, and we haven't even gotten through the first night. He halted by Zelda. If you see Aurora, tell her that if she thinks the organizers of this batty conference are done with her, she's going to be bowled over by me. I'll sue her and the entire Spirit, Health, and Heart Conference for breach of contract, and to get the place fumigated while I'm at it. Without another word, he turned and stormed off into the night. The three of us stared through the empty doorway for several moments before Zelda shut and locked it with a sigh.
I don't think I can take any more. I can't even blame Duke at this point. I want to just crawl into a hole and hide.
Watson whimpered pitifully.
Oh, right.
Zelda chuckled softly, and her voice lightened somewhat.
I promised you a treat, didn't I? Promised all of us a treat. Well, now I need it more than ever.
She motioned for me to follow.
Come on, then.
I should say no. I'll use commiserating with your stress as an excuse, though. Katie did a run-through of the quiches for your opening tomorrow, and I think I ate my own weight from the constant sampling. But that's just one thing Watson and I have in common. Neither one of us can turn down a treat. As I repeated the euphoric word, Watson renewed his hopping as we followed Zelda through Chakras. The only illumination was the innumerable fairy lights covering the hardwood ceiling, which created a soft glow over the space. In the soothing dim light, I didn't notice any changes since I'd been in the last time. I was still pleasantly surprised at how the store had come together. I'd expected the shop to be a huge mishmash of incomparable items, random, brassy, and scattered, rather like the twins themselves. Despite Chakras displaying the true essence of Zelda and Verona, the store was utterly charming, even if I didn't know what half the things were. It fit in with the feel of the town perfectly. I supposed I shouldn't have been surprised. Estes Park had its heyday in the 1960s. Though a lot of the residents of the little Colorado mountain town had plenty of money, there was still an undercurrent of those naturalistic flower child days of the past. Chakras captured that whimsy, with wind chimes, brass gongs, statues of fairies and mermaids, crystals and jewelry, and pleasingly displayed clothing that looked like it was designed for yuppies who preferred tie-dye to ball gowns. Passing through a doorway of silver beads, Zelda flipped on the light and led us into a small break room with a compact kitchenette. She opened the cabinets and pulled a plastic bag from beside a row of jarred granola, then withdrew a large dried strip of jerky.
"It's buffalo, and especially for dogs. Polly special ordered it for us. We're going to have monthly pet yoga sessions, so we thought it might come in handy."
Clearly expecting one of his favorite dog biscuit treats, Watson sniffed the withered-looking strip cautiously. Then his chocolate eyes widened, and he snatched it from Zelda so quickly she nearly lost a finger.
"Good grief, Watson. No need to be ungracious."
Watson didn't attempt to make amends for his rudeness, only stared pleadingly at me and gave another tug of his leash. I complied, and he trotted back through the beads into the store to devour his new treasure in private. I turned back to Zelda.
"I don't know whether to thank you or be angry at you. It looks like Watson's going to have another favorite treat, and I can't imagine special-ordered buffalo jerky is cheap."
"You can afford it. The bookshop is doing wonderfully."
Zelda waved me off and turned toward the freezer, shoving aside several items until she finally turned back around with two pint-sized cartons in her hands.
"Here you go."
She thrust one at me before going to a drawer and retrieving two spoons. I studied the label that read, "Frozen Tofu Delight," and then gave a scowl at Zelda that Watson would have been proud of.
"I think you and I have different definitions of what constitutes a treat."
Only then did I notice the specific flavor and nearly gagged.
"Red bean and avocado? You must have lied before. You are angry at me for not helping the past couple of days. But trying to kill me seems a little extreme."
Zelda handed me a spoon and laughed.
"Just try it."
Suddenly, I longed for the days when I'd been an only child. Sure, there were times when I'd wished for a brother or sister, but there'd not been any moments like this. And no matter how much I'd grown to care about Zelda and Verona, I wasn't sure any love was worth red beans and avocado. Even so, I removed the lid and glanced down, determined to at least give it the old college try. To my surprise, it didn't look half bad. In fact, it seemed rather familiar. In between bites, Zelda smirked at me from where she was leaning against the counter.
"Go ahead, try it."
I dug my spoon in and lifted up a small cluster with brown speckles that didn't resemble red beans or avocados. No sooner did the morsel touch my tongue than I pointed the spoon at Zelda.
"Cookie dough!"
I dug another bite, bigger that time, and got a different chunk of heaven. I didn't bother to swallow before speaking.
"I would know this anywhere. This is Ben and Jerry's half-baked cookie dough and brownie batter."
"Can't be. That's not what the carton says."
Zelda grinned wickedly and took another heaping spoonful. I'd caught Zelda at the ice cream parlor a while ago, sneaking behind Verona's back, so I knew that she didn't stick to the no-processed sugar rule that the twins claim to live by.
"You're brazen to keep this here. What if Verona gets hungry for..."
I had to check the label.
"Frozen Tofu Delight."
"She won't. She doesn't really like any of the flavors, but she absolutely detests the red bean and avocado. This is as safe as if it were invisible."
She took another bite and sighed, her eyes rolling back in her head.
"And trust me, I've more than earned it."
"Well, you're brave, I'll give you that. And thank you for not making me try anything flavored with red beans and avocado."
We ate in silence for a few moments, each relishing the sheer ice cream perfection. Part of me hated to spoil such a treat, but it seemed that Zelda needed to vent. I'd never filled that role for her, or Verona for that matter, though we'd been in the same family for over 6 years. But I suppose there was no time like the present to try on a deeper sisterly role. "I've noticed things between you and Verona have been a little tense lately. I bet that will get better as you guys settle into a routine and everything."
As soon as the words left my mouth, I worried that it sounded like I was trying to gossip about Verona. Zelda didn't seem to notice, or at least she didn't mind.
You can say that again. It's like I don't know my own sister. She's always been a little more...
She waggled a spoonful of ice cream in the air.
Dogmatic, I suppose, but she's downright controlling at the moment. Ever since we decided to open Chakras...
Zelda winced and then backpedaled.
That's not really fair. She's been a little more intense ever since we decided to open the store. But it hasn't really been until the past few days that she's gone into full-blown controlling.
Once Zelda started to talk, it was clear that she truly had needed to vent, as the words seemed to pour out of her.
I know it's just the conference and having Aurora and Wolf Birnbaum lead some of their sessions here at the store, but I'm not sure how much more I can take. Don't get me wrong, I was nearly beside myself when Aurora decided to take such an interest in Chakras, but I didn't know it would be like this. I've always looked up to her, not as much as Verona does, but quite a bit. But the reality is different from what I expected.
Zelda glanced around as if she too expected to see Aurora Birnbaum lurking around the corner and lowered her voice.
For someone who's so in touch with a deeper level of spiritualism and awareness, the woman is rather awful. Duke's not the most pleasant of men, but like I said, if he's dealing with Aurora, I can't blame him.
The whole family had heard of little else for weeks besides Zelda and Verona's excitement about Aurora and Wolf headlining the conference and incorporating Chakras into a daily event. That had been why I'd special ordered a few of the Birnbaum's books for the Cozy Corgi. I hadn't met them in person yet. With my history in publishing, however, it wouldn't be the first time I'd met someone famous in a book genre who didn't quite live up to the persona they had crafted for public consumption. I'm guessing she's a little more businesswoman than spiritual leader? Zelda winced and took several moments before she responded.
It's not my place to comment on someone else's beliefs or spiritualism, and I shouldn't discount what she claims. They've built a huge career and helped multitudes of people.
She lifted the half-eaten pint of Ben & Jerry's like she held a whiskey bottle.
Like I have any room to judge. I'm not exactly as I present either, am I? And yet, here I am, complaining about Verona while eating this behind her back.
I really didn't see the correlation between sneaking ice cream and the New Age guru treating those around her in a horrible manner. But I'd never quite understood the dynamic between Zelda and Verona. I'd simply chalked it up to a twin thing. Zelda shook her shoulders and tossed back her long brunette hair.
Enough of that. I'll do an extra long meditation this evening before I go to bed, another one in the morning, and then throw myself into the conference. I'll get grounded and have a new perspective.
Black obsidian is good if a person is wanting to be grounded. I believe you're supposed to sleep with it in your pillowcase. The look Zelda gave me made me wonder if I'd sprouted feathers.
You're more like your mother than I realized.
Feeling like a phony, I shrugged. I was reading one of Aurora's books before I came over. I can't actually say I understood much of it. Zelda chuckled and relaxed.
Honestly, it makes me feel better that you don't. I thought I'd stumbled through a portal into a different dimension.
She walked away from the counter, carrying her ice cream as she headed toward the beaded doorway.
Come on, enough of my complaining. Let me show you what we've been working on. I think it's the highlight of Chakras.
Mimicking her example, I helped myself to some more ice cream and followed her into the shop. We turned instantly to another beaded doorway, though this one was strung with nearly transparent, jagged crystals. I held a strand as we slipped inside. Are these clear quartz? Zelda gave an approving nod.
You're a quick study, Winifred Page. Not that I'm surprised.
She flicked the switch beside the door, and more dim fairy lights came on overhead. Across the room, Watson sat up straight in obvious surprise, what little remained of the large piece of buffalo jerky clenched in his mouth. Zelda laughed at his clear annoyance at being disturbed.
It seems Watson approves of the room.
Clutching the jerky, Watson lifted his nose in the air and trotted past us to find more privacy. Those treats might actually be worth what you pay for them. Typically, anything I give that dog lasts a matter of 10 seconds, tops. That's rather amazing. Before I could inquire exactly how much the jerky cost, Zelda flicked another switch, and I all but forgot about premium jerky for dogs. Stones and crystals of every color had been mixed throughout the river rock that covered the walls. Each of them had been backlit and glowed with ethereal beauty. On the far side of the room, a narrow fall of water trickled over stones into a small, shallow pool. Zelda, I continued to spin slowly, unable to take it all in. This is... I don't know how to describe it. It's unreal.
I'm glad you like it.
Like it? I leveled my gaze on her. It's like I just stepped into Narnia or something. She let out a pleased laugh.
We think so, too. This is the room that we'll rent out for special events, like the ones Aurora and Wolf will do this week. Different healing and yoga sessions, guided meditation. It will also be where we'll have one of the massage therapists from Pinecone Manor come down a few times a week.
Everywhere I looked, there was one more tiny detail that I'd missed. A streak of moss growing over some of the stones, small flowering plants scattered here and there, clusters of crystal pendants dangled from the ceiling on thin silver chains. Shoving all the individual things together should have been too much, way too much. But somehow it wasn't. This is quite literally perfect. I'm blown away. Zelda visibly relaxed even more.
I'm so glad you think so. I know you've never said it, and you're kind enough you never would, but I figured you were nervous having Verona and me on one side of the bookshop, and probably doubly worried since our husbands are working on opening the store on the other side of you. But we really do want this to be a place that you're proud of.
Words were stolen from me for a moment. I had been worried. Even so, I'd not expected Zelda to be concerned with it. The store was theirs. They could do whatever they wanted. I was touched that I'd even been a consideration. Zelda, you don't have to think twice about that. But even if you did, you definitely don't now. The whole thing is stunning. But please don't worry about me. Make it what you want. She was only a couple of inches shorter than my 5'10" frame, and thin and wispy in comparison, but easily threw her arm over my shoulder and gave me a quick squeeze.
We're family. Of course your opinion matters, especially considering how angry some people in town are that we're opening a new age shop. I don't want that to affect you.
None of us had expected there to be any resistance to the shop. Estes wasn't exactly narrow-minded. The church is still bugging you?
She nodded. Yes. Just today there was a note shoved under the...
Tinkling chime sounded, cutting her off. From the main room, Watson let out a muffled bark as if he still had his mouth full, and then Verona's voice cut through the space. Zelda, are you here? Though she flinched in surprise, as Zelda raised her voice, she retained some of the ease that had returned as we'd spoken.
Back in the crystal room, with Fred.
Oh, good. The tap of Verona's footsteps over the hardwood floor grew louder as she neared, though they paused as she greeted Watson. Another second or so, she parted the crystals hanging over the door and entered. A nervous expression covered her face that Zelda had demonstrated only moments before.
Do you like it?
Yes, I was just telling Zelda. It's complete perfection. So much so it would almost make me consider coming to one of your crystal healing thingamabobs. As soon as the words left my lips, I realized they weren't true. Or a massage. I will definitely schedule a massage. Verona beamed. Once more, her expression matched her twin. They were completely identical. The only difference between them was Verona's long blonde hair compared to Zelda's brown. I'm so glad. So very glad. Her demeanor shifted instantly, and her blue eyes hardened as she turned to Zelda. I can't believe you left opening night early when Aurora and Wolf were right there. Zelda's ease vanished.
I'm sorry. I just needed to get away.
Well, Aurora noticed. How do you think that looks? Verona took a couple steps closer to her sister. Though I knew neither of them had an ounce of violence in their bodies, her posture was aggressive, as was her tone.
I'll tell you how it looks. It looks like we're not committed, that this is just a store or a hobby to us, not a lifestyle. She could change her mind in a moment and decide to do their events at the conference space instead of here. I wouldn't blame her.
You might want to be concerned about our reputation with Duke, since he's local. He was in here a while ago looking for you and Aurora.
Zelda tilted her chin.
And as far as she's concerned, I suggest you be careful, Verona. Maybe what will make Aurora change her mind is if she hears you talk about this place as if you're worried about profit and exposure, as opposed to fostering a lifestyle.
Verona gasped. Feeling awkward, I was about to step through the crystals and give the twins their space, when Verona gasped again and snatched the carton out of Zelda's hand.
What is this?
Nothing.
Zelda reached for it, but Verona pivoted and stepped out of reach.
It's just tofu delight.
Tilting the carton toward one of the glowing crystals on the wall, Verona's eyes narrowed. She dug in a finger, retrieved a small mound, and popped it into her mouth. She straightened to a rigid pull instantly and spit the bite back in.
Ice cream.
She took a step back, glaring at Zelda with a mix of horror and betrayal.
Sugar.
She held up the carton to read the fake name, then shoved it back at Zelda before whirling around and storming away. 2.
Here, Fred, hold these while I make some room.
Mom dumped a handful of silver necklaces with purple crystals hanging from them into my hands and began rearranging the other jewelry on the display.
I made these several months ago after I got in a huge shipment of amethysts, then put them away for safekeeping. Of course, I spent the past several weeks searching for the safe place. Barry found them this morning under the bacon in the deep freezer when he went to make breakfast.
You put them in the deep freezer? I attempted to untangle the silver strands, then paused. Wait a minute. What's bacon? As soon as the words left my mouth, I remembered who we were talking about.
Hold on. Don't answer that. It's vegan bacon, isn't it?
Mom stood back from the display and nodded, though I wasn't sure if it was at me or if she was satisfied with her rearranging. One by one, she took the necklaces from me and situated them in the newly cleared section.
I don't remember putting them in the freezer, but it worked. There they were, safe and sound, happy as could be.
I didn't know there was such a demand for amethyst that it would require a hiding place. I tried to keep the teasing tone out of my voice. I knew how important Mom's jewelry making was to her.
At one point in history, amethyst was valued as highly as diamonds.
Katie, my best friend and owner of the bakery above the bookshop, appeared from nowhere, holding a platter of mini quiches.
It was also known as the jewel of the gods.
She started to say more, doubtlessly some further random trivia about the purple rock, but glanced down as Watson emerged from his hiding place under my broomstick skirt and swatted her foot with his paw.
Oh, no, buddy, no quiche for you. Too much dairy.
He doesn't need it anyway. Zelda's already given him 2 huge portions of buffalo jerky. Feeling slightly guilty for rubbing it in Watson's face, I snagged one of the quiches and popped it into my mouth. I'll be glad when this is over. I think I've gained 10 pounds over the last week from your quiches alone. She grinned, her round cheeks flushing in pleasure.
You're not the only one putting on quiche weight. I've gone through more than 300 of these little guys today.
I'm not surprised. The girls are having a really amazing turnout.
Mom took the last amethyst necklace from me and hung it with the others.
It's so sweet of them to give me my own spot in their store for my jewelry. I just have to say, I love your hair.
A small yet powerfully built, stunningly beautiful woman stepped between Mom and Katie and reached out with her right hand, lightly fingering the beaded coil Mom had woven through the one remaining strand of auburn in her long silver hair.
This is beautiful.
Oh, thank you, dear.
Mom beamed and returned the gesture, touching the green crystals woven into the blonde dreadlocks.
And this is lovely. Aventurine?
Yes, it enhances intelligence.
She cast her wide teal blue gaze at Watson, then gave a giddy wave to me, then Katie.
Hi there. I actually came over to snag one of these little pies from you.
She plucked one of the quiches off the tray Katie held.
Help yourself.
Katie didn't correct her on what the pies actually were, but gave her a once-over.
I have to say, you're adorable. Rather like a new-age Barbie, one with muscle tone.
She clapped her hands in delight, which caused a waterfall of quiche crumbs, much to Watson's satisfaction.
Thank you. That's such a sweet thing to say.
She stuck out her tiny hand.
I'm Tabitha, Aurora's assistant and her personal yoga and Pilates instructor.
As we did a round of introductions, I had to bite my cheek to keep from laughing. Katie's description was spot on. Tabitha had the body, face, and cheery personality of a life-sized Barbie, all dressed in a skin-tight, tie-dyed wrap that left little to the imagination.
I also love your shoes, dear.
Mom glanced down to where Watson was snorting at the blue and gold tie-dyed stilettos.
I think you might be standing on some quiche.
With a giggle, Tabitha lifted a foot and made room for Watson to snag the morsel.
Thank you again. They're gorgeous, right?
They were a gift from Aurora. Confusion crossed her features, and she glanced across the store to where the New Age guru chatted with a small group of people.
She gave them to me yesterday. First gift I've gotten in the 3 years I've worked for her.
She twisted her ankle to show off the shoes.
But they're Camilla. I looked them up online. They cost over $1,000 a pair.
Katie nearly choked. Gracious as always, Mom patted Tabitha's shoulder.
They really are stunning. You must be quite the assistant. Most of the time, I don't think so.
Her confusion deepened and then vanished without a trace as she snagged two more quiches.
Wolf's demonstration is starting in a few minutes. I'm going to take these to him if you don't mind. He works so hard.
With another giggle and wave, made awkward by crumbling quiches, Tabitha headed back toward the crystal room, Watson scampering happily in her crumb-filled wake. We watched her go. Then Katie eyed Mom and lowered her voice to a teasing tone.
What did she say those stones in her hair were for again?
Intelligence, dear. Aventurine helps with...
Mom's eyes widened and she swatted at Katie with a laugh.
Oh, stop it. You're awful.
As they chatted, I looked around Chakras. The place was packed. There were a few locals I recognized, but most were people I'd never seen before. I assumed the vast majority were from the conference.
It was a very good thing, for many reasons. Simply for the success of the event in the shop, but even more than that, it was keeping the twins occupied.
I'd witnessed many spats between Verona and Zelda, but I'd never seen anything like this. The coldness between them was palpable. Verona seemed furious, and Zelda was clearly humiliated. I was still kicking myself for not acting quicker the night before. It hadn't even entered my mind that the two of us had been standing there eating ice cream when Verona walked in. Maybe the complete success of the grand opening would ease the tension between them. Katie nudged my shoulder, bringing me back to the moment.
I'll catch you later. I'm going to go make the rounds again.
You don't have to play waitress. It's enough that you're catering the event. I snagged another quiche from the tray, despite my sentiments. Katie shrugged, followed my lead, and snatched up a quiche of her own, and only chewed for a couple of moments before speaking.
It's kind of fun. Plus, all the walking counts as exercise, or close enough. And it's not like Ben and Nick need me at the Cozy Corgi. They can handle things on their own, and everyone's over here anyway.
She leaned in, lowering her voice just enough to only be heard by Mom and myself.
Everyone's raving about the quiches, except for the headliner herself. Kinda surprised me. She was so nice to everyone else, but when I offered her some, she looked at me as if I was trying to give her sewage. Wanted to know if all the ingredients were certified organic. She winked. I told her I got up early this morning and milked the cow myself and turned it into cheese. She didn't seem to find that humorous.
Mom swatted at Katie a second time. You are too much. No wonder I adore you.
The feeling is mutual, Phyllis.
Katie straightened and returned to normal volume before spinning and heading away.
And great job on the crystals. They're going to be a smash hit.
As we watched her go, Watson returned, slipped under the hem of my skirt to avoid the crowd of people walking by, and rested his head on the toe of my boot. Mom gave me a meaningful stare.
You know I don't like to be negative, but I have to agree with Katie. There's something a little...
She shook her head, but didn't finish the thought.
What?
It was really rare for my mom to say anything bad about anyone, or even to start to in this case.
She sighed, giving in. Just the way she treats Verona and Zelda, and...
She held up a hand.
I know they're off because of that ice cream incident last night, though I'm glad the cat's out of the bag finally on that little issue. But still, when Aurora is talking to the other people in the shop, she has this kind, gentle, almost ethereal tone. But as soon as one of the twins comes up to her, she becomes condescending and demanding, almost...
She winced.
Arrogant.
At that moment, Aurora Birnbaum let out a bell-like laugh as she departed from her group of admirers. Ethereal was a good descriptor for the woman. Though I assumed she was in her mid-50s, she had an ageless quality. Tall, willowy, and graceful. Soft chestnut hair was fixed on her head in a loose bun and long tendrils floated around her face. At first glance, the way she held her chin and looked like the mannerism of a gracious deity as she wove through the customers in the shop, pausing here and there to whisper and chat. But, after hearing Mom and Katie's take on the woman, I couldn't help but now interpret it as elitist. Apparently feeling my attention, her soft gray eyes flicked to me and held my gaze. After a moment, she smiled slightly and looked away once more. I turned toward Mom.
They live in Estes during the summer, right? Then spend the rest of the year in Sedona? Haven't you met her before?
Mom shook her head.
I've seen Aurora and her husband Wolf from a distance a few times while Barry and I were out to dinner or something, but no, I've never been introduced. The twins have met her before, but I think they're having a different experience this time from what I can tell. It's kind of like what your dad used to say about certain preachers or politicians. Sometimes when good people get in positions of power, they let it go to their heads. I know Barry met Wolf at a farmer's market a couple of summers back. He felt like the man was genuine and...
She sucked in a breath as her eyes went wide.
Barry! I completely forgot. With the truck in the shop, we only have the Volkswagen and he was getting ready when I left. I told him I was just going to drop these off and come right back to get him.
She patted her thighs.
I must have left my purse and phone in the van.
She got up on tiptoe and gave me a quick peck on the cheek.
I'll be back in a little bit, dear. Sorry.
And with that, she was gone. I pulled myself from the pocket of my shirt, but there was no missed call from Barry. Doubtlessly, he was patiently waiting at home. He was used to Mom's forgetfulness, and he was so easygoing there was a good chance he'd not even noticed. Without Mom or Katie by my side, I felt a little awkward just standing there. Honestly, I was a little out of place. In the bookshop, I'd have endless topics of conversation, but here, I wasn't exactly sure how to approach people. I didn't mind the aspects of the New Age shop, or the lifestyle the twins embraced, or the more hippie flower child sensibilities Mom and my stepfather had. But beyond that, I was at a loss. I knew others found it odd that I could lose myself in a series of books and feel as close to the characters as I did to flesh and blood friends. Still, I was afraid if I tried to converse about some of the items in the store, I'd accidentally offend someone.
A soft smattering of applause issued from behind the wall.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.